men have a hard time working on the common good, especially if you are part of an economic system. What we see is that we are driven by self-interest. And the storyline is normally known as tragedy of the commons. So if we have one sea with fish and a lot of fishers, we will see the fishers depleting the sea. If we have a meadow where several people can feed their sheep, we will see that they put so much sheep on them that the grass cannot grow in time. So what I'm going to address in this talk is how we can work with this tragedy of the commons. My name is Jan-Peter Doomernik, but most people call me JP, and I work for Enexis, a grid company. What the grid company does is we own the electricity cables and the gas pipes in the ground. So it's a very traditional business. Why do we do that? We want to ensure the right to energy. There was a moment in time that the Dutch government were selling the energy companies. So they put everything which is commercial, like production and customers, on one half. And then they said, well, if we own the grid, so all the electricity cables and pipes in the ground, then we can ensure the right to energy, because we always are part of the system. I work in the Department of Strategical Transitions. Basically, what we do is we are no longer the innovation departments that answers questions, but we look for the questions that nobody asks. And if you look at the world of tomorrow, we see companies like Uber who say, we want to be the utility of transportation. What you see them doing is making a giant database with all the rights. And you can imagine that as soon as they have self-driving cars, they can drive everybody around. But at the evening, those self-driving cars will be standing there and will be doing nothing. So it won't be that big of a step to use those cars and to start driving energy around. And what I said is we were there to ensure the right to energy. As soon as self-driving cars become a movable energy grid, we actually would have an alternative system. And where we are non-profit and focused on beneficial solutions for everybody, the company would be focused on making money. And maybe not always be that nice to the customers or their employees, especially when you look at Uber and you Google what they are doing, you see that they are very much profit-driven, which not always leads to the best solutions. What we like to do is to look at those solutions and think, how can we make them caring, so taking care of people, and inclusive, so it's a right for everybody. The tragedy of the commons says that people work out of self-interest. That's it's why it's a tragedy. I found a story online, the story of stuff, and what they explained me there is that the way our economic system is works today is very much built on those fundamentals. So what they explain in the first minutes of the video is how the value chain works. And then you say, oh, that's very logical. And then they say, well, because of this value chain, we have this great thing which is called economic growth. And then you say, ah, that's nice, because every time I read economic growth, I think it's going good. But because it's a value chain, to have the economic growth we have today, we have to throw away 98% of all the goods we bought in the last 6 months. So to keep the economic growth up to speed, we have to destroy resources. And we have been playing this game for a number of years. So we have gotten very good in it. We have things that break. We have things that go out of fashion. And we have find ways we can make things so cheap by outsourcing costs that there's only a little hump for buying them. But outsourcing costs means that we let a workforce work under conditions where they go sick, or we take so much away of the materials that they isn't any ability to restore itself. So how can we break this narrative of self-interest? And it probably is not going to be about money. What we are working on is machines that operate autonomous. And if you have a blockchain, you can, of course, imagine a car that operates fully automated. So you have actually a machine that adds value. There's also now already first experiments, and actually we are doing one of those experiments with BigChain ourselves on self-owned machines and maintaining entities. Here I'm talking about the forest Terra Zero, which actually is a forest where there's a picture taken every half year. Then, based on the picture, it is decided which trees to cut. And the money of those trees ensures that the forest can maintain itself. So we have autonomous machine that can work, and we have self-owned machines. Even the World Economic Forum is talking about self-owned machines. What we like to do is to build infrastructures of machine to machine who own themselves. And we did a thought experiment. If we take a city of 50,000 people and we put in 10,000 self-owned machines, starting day one, they would make transportation 5 times cheaper. And that's already a thing that people understand today. If we talk about basic income, we also did a little thought experiment. Let's say we ask a little bit extra of as that 20%. Then we would have an incoming money stream to raise to the amount of cars we need for that city, which would be 20,000 cars. As soon as we have 20,000 cars, the city has all the cars it needs for its transportation, and we have an incoming money stream. We could turn it then around and give the money back to the people as basic income. Because the machines own themselves, they are machines, they don't care about money. Huh? We have created the machines who own themselves, but given them their freedom. And they are still things, and they are not super intelligent, more intelligent than we are now. So basically, playing with these new values, we can create new economic system where we give money back to the people, because we say AI and job loss, but what we care about sometimes is that we have enough money to live, and maybe the job can then change. What you see happening on the right side on the picture, wait again, is that we can also, on the sidewalk, the machines that help the cars, the energy points, the car wash, the repair shops can also be machines. So that is how we can build machine-to-machine infrastructures. And the funny thing, if you have machine-to-machine infrastructures, then you have entities who do not care about money. So those transactions could be moneyless. And those transactions also don't need identity. It's more like the transactions we know from nature and not from economics. And of course, what I said at Uber, the self-owned machines could also do, they could not only disrupt the way we do transportation, we could also disrupt the way we transport energy. So what if we could create agents for the common good? Well, machines, AIs, DAOs have no urge for money, so that's a very good point. But, and that's where I dip into AI, Machines do not understand what they do. What you see here is the way children learn. And first they remember, then they understand, and then there are all those steps towards creativity. What we are doing now in AI is basic relearning them tricks. But they are not able to understand what they are doing. They are not able to build on it like we do with humans. So the gap now there is to understand. There is Monica Anderson, who is working on artificial intuition. I have hopes for that because she's actually using this kind of models. But for me, it is important that if we create agents for the common good, we look at those agents and we know that they are things, they have no self-interest, this is good. But at first, we have to help them because they do not understand what they are doing. So, our project with BigchainDB is we creating the first machines who own themselves. We are working on the AI DAO as a starting point, the DAO that creates art. Trent has written a lot about it. We are now building it. And for the second step, we are already working with Joris Lamon Webs on creating a physical machine who owns itself to get more connected to the physical world. So what we have check is they do not act for themselves because they are things. In the version one of the system, we are working on a protective shield, the notary, where we use blockchain to enforce that it cannot be manipulated as agents for somebody else. And where we help the first machines, because the first machines are sole entities, so they will have incoming money streams, that this money goes out for the common good. In this case, Article 25.1 of the Human Rights Charter, everybody has a right for food, for health, for housing. That's how the money is going to be spent, or giving away as basic income. In the second part, we are going to use the machines to interact with other machines. And that means that you had just had the bubble, you will see those interactions exist in the bubble. And that's where we have the interactions without identity, without money, just delivering value to society. And the great thing is that the AIs don't have to be much more intelligent than they are today. Because we already now have the self-driving car in our heads. And it doesn't have to have a bad temper or something like that. As long as it is able to drive us around, it can offer these services. I think starting this venture with BigchainDB, with other non-for-profits, is something which could really be unstoppable. Why? Because we have this great thing, it's called blockchain, and where the internet turned the world into in one giant server, blockchain is transforming that server to one giant computer. And if you solve a problem once on the Earth, it's accessible everywhere on the Earth. So that means that if in Germany, by law, they would forbid such kind of beneficial systems for society, we could build it in Luxembourg or in any other country, and then start the discussion why we cannot have it here. And the second great thing is that it helps us to get rid of all the crazy ideas, all the crazy storylines we are used to thinking. So, for example, I come from the energy business. The sun delivers 6,000 times the amount of energy we need. This morning as you woke up, the sun was shining, delivering the energy to your roof. You only needed 1 meter below in your socket. So you have that giant layer of raw energy everywhere on the Earth. We now have the energy industry, which is heavily invested on the old solutions. It's telling you that we have to spend less energy. But there's an abundance of raw energy. And you already have elements like the artificial leaves of MIT who take sunlight and turn it into hydrogen. So if you have self-driving cars driving around, they only have to connect the hydrogen from the artificial leaves. So if we start system like this, we can just look at what is the engineering problem to solve, and we can get rid of all the crazy things we do to make money and create lock-ins, and all the things we normally seem so caught up in. So, I would like to invite you all to co-create with us. We are doing the first project, Machines to Own Themselves, with BigchainDB. We're also preparing the second one, Machine-to-Machine Infrastructures, but this also will be a track on the hackathon in Groningen, and they say it's going to be the biggest hackathon in the world. We have our own track, beneficial for society. We're going to work on machine-to-machine ecosystems. We're going to build them on the IOTA platform, just to get known with the narrative, known with the storylines. I think this is very important, because giving society those entities who work without self-interest could be a very important step forward. Thank you very much for your interest.
Thank you, JP. We have one short question. Try to keep it short.
Is this working? Oh, cool. Thank you for the talk. I find the topic fascinating, and I think you know all the positivity that you're promoting is awesome. So you said something around that these machines cannot be manipulated to act for the self-interest of others. Yet earlier in the talk, you said that these machines don't need any identity or money. So how would you actually guarantee that?
Yeah. No identity and no money is as soon as they are among themselves. Mm-hmm. So we, as humans, have a lot of services that are important for us, but we forget at the moment we go to sleep. For some people, that is the way they were transported from A to B. For other people, that were the clothes they wear. For a third group of people, that is what they eat. But there are services we can automate for people without changing their lives. That is machine to machine. That is no identity, no money. The first machines we are going to create, because we are starting the transition today, is that and read all the stuff Trent wrote about AI DAO, because it's a perfect example, that will be machines who actually make money, because if we start the transition today, they will be part of the economic system of today. So how can we create them then to be for the good of humans? First, we build a shield around them so that every transaction they have with the outside world that goes through that shield, and that the machine, for example, doesn't have any money that is viable in the outside world, so it cannot be robbed. We use the shield to check if the machine cannot be manipulated in any way, because if it's open for manipulation, then people could use it for their self-interest. So as soon as that happens, they lose the status of the self-owned machine, the machine beneficial for society. So that's step one, to get the narrative out and to tell the people what's happening and to already have some first results. And from this step one, this what we call generation one, we're going to move towards two, the machines who interact with machines, and that will be the topic of the hackathon in Groningen in April.
Thank you.
Thank you, JP.
Yep.